Can you see that? Breakfast at Sweethearts, 1979, album by Cold Chisel. Breakfast at Sweethearts, the Don Walker album, the Sydney album, the King's Cross album. It's hard to say when I exactly found or discovered Cold Chisel. They were always there in the background. When I left school in the mid-90s, got my license, was able to go to pubs, Cold Chisel were ever present on any jukebox or a cover band at the time. We had no mobile phones and streaming services, but you could rest assured that if you were in a pub in Australia and a jukebox, a Cold Chisel song would come up eventually. Most Australians, when they think of Cold Chisel, think of their songs like standalone songs. And thinking of them as an albums band, it's kind of been lost, I think. And they really were a great albums band. I think their early discography is one of the best of any Australian bands. You can really follow their progression and evolution through their first five albums in particular. So I did like Cold Chisel. I certainly liked a lot of their songs, their singles, but never really explored them any deeper than that. But like everything, chance played its card, and one day I was exposed to hearing an actual Cold Chisel album in the unlikeliest of places. We're out camping in the Alpine region of Victoria, and a fellow camper had Breakfast at Sweethearts CD playing in his car, and I absolutely loved it. I was listening to it, didn't know any of the songs, and found out that it was an actual Cold Chisel album. And sometime after that, I got a job out in Burrellin in New South Wales, and those songs from that CD from that particular time wouldn't leave my head. And thank God I inquired and found out what album it was, and made a trip into the town of Griffith, went to the CD shop, $15, the CD was there, so I bought it. And probably you can say I'm a little bit biased, first album bias. Usually people rate highly the first album of a band they've heard. In this case, for me, I did hear Breakfast at Sweethearts first before any other Cold Chisel album. And to this day, yep, it is my favorite Cold Chisel album. And I just hope that other people discover this album, because I really think it is one of the underrated masterpieces of Australian music.
Hey Threads, can you just give us a quick history on Chisel from 1973 up to just before they started to record Breakfast at Sweethearts?
So this is the Gawler Racetrack, and today there is a race meet, and it's almost Christmas. There's a few people here. It's going to be a few races. But this actually is a very significant place in Australia's musical history. In 1973, there was an event here. It was to raise money for a local primary school at the town of Evanston, right near here. And they booked a few bands, but one of the bands they booked was called Orange. And the band Orange was a five-piece band which was fronted by a charismatic Scotsman named Jimmy Barnes. It wasn't long after that show that they decided to change their name. And the name they chose was Cold Chisel. And this is where it really all began for that band. Their first performance was here at the racetrack back in 1973. After their first gig in Gawler, the band underwent a few lineup changes until 1975, when the dust finally settled on the lineup we all know and love. That being Steve Prestwich on drums, Phil Small on bass, Don Walker on piano, guitarist and vocalist Ian Moss, and last but certainly not least, the aforementioned Scotsman Jimmy Barnes on lead vocals. Chisel had forged a loyal following in their home city of Adelaide, ripping to shreds various pubs and clubs nightly from north to the south to the CBD and everywhere in between. While playing as a successful cover band, behind the scenes, Don Walker, a man of few words, was crafting a number of original songs, placing the working class, downtrodden and forgotten about Australians on centre stage. The shadows of Australian existence in all its stunted reality were about to be given the spotlight, with a sound to shake the very marrow of your bones. By 1976, Cold Chisel sought new horizons and wanted to expand their audience. They decided to move to Melbourne, a known centre for rock bands to get noticed. Melbourne, however, didn't quite warm to the band like Adelaide, and Chisel stalled as a result. This brought about tensions. Some of the tensions became so strong that Jimmy Barnes would leave the band on several occasions, only to come back days or weeks later. Something had to change for the band. They had to move on from Adelaide, but where if not Melbourne? On Don Walker's reckoning, the only other place worth aiming for is Sydney. And with a bit of convincing, Chisel took their chances and in 1977, relocated to the suburbs of Sydney. Chisel's gamble on moving to Sydney seemed to pay dividends. With regular gigs, it wasn't long until they got their break and were signed to Warner Music Australia. In early 1978, Chisel recorded their self-titled debut album, which peaked at a respectable 31 on the Australian Albums Chart. Having 8 original tracks, which is significant for a debut album, it showed that new Australian bands could indeed write quality songs. The album's only single, K-San, a song about a disillusioned Vietnam War veteran trying to find meaning in his mixed-up life, had peaked at 41 on the Australian Singles Chart. This song, however, would grow in popularity over the years to become one of Chisel's and Australia's most beloved songs ever. In almost the same breath as the release of their debut album, Cold Chisel also released a 5-track live EP called You're 13, You're Beautiful, and You're Mine. Chisel, above anything else, consider themselves a great live band in which this EP would showcase their raw onstage energy. The EP contained a new song called Merry-Go-Round, and although raw, it would hint at where Chisel were heading. Don Walker was now living quietly near King's Cross and had been formulating his thoughts into a new collection of songs, inspired by all that was happening in and around him, centering on King's Cross. Cold Chisel had certainly come a long way from Adelaide since moving to Sydney. Living in Sydney had brought new perspective and inspiration, and it was in this atmosphere Chisel began their slow march to birth their second album and started recording in July 1978. The title of this second album would be inspired from a small cafe which Don Walker would frequently visit and pen his lyrics in solitude. This cafe was called Breakfast at Sweethearts was always going to be a challenge for Cold Chisel. It was their second album, and second albums are always met with high expectations from not only the band, but the record label. The albums have got to be an improvement than their predecessors, and the record company always want hits to sell the album, which is in conflict with a band like Cold Chisel because their philosophy was they were an albums band. The album is the true expression of the band. Songs have got to be good, but they don't want to be judged on a single song. In a nutshell, a poor second album can either make or break a band. The record company Warner had chosen for Cold Chisel a producer for their second album, and that was Richard Batchens. And Richard Batchens was known in the industry as an engineer as well as a producer, and had produced artists such as Sherbet and Richard Clapton. And, you know, no doubt Richard Batchens was under pressure from the record company to create a successful second album for Cold Chisel. So when Chisel started to record their second album in July of 78, they were hoping to get Studio One of Albert Studios in Sydney. Unfortunately, they were double booked. Albert Studios said, "You can use our brand new studio," which sounded good, but upon arrival, it soon turned out that this new studio didn't really have a warm feeling about it, and it really did affect the recordings of the band. And, you know, it was a bit of a letdown for them, because recording in Studio One would have put them up there with the ranks of AC/DC and the Angels, who had produced so many hit records in Studio One at Albert in Sydney. But they carried on anyway. Now, usually when a band records an album, they like to do it in a single block, and it could take weeks or months to record, but distractions are usually kept to a minimum. So they might only play one or two gigs, but the focus of that time is to record a new album. Unfortunately, that wasn't the case for Breakfast at Sweethearts. Chisel had only released one album prior, and due to that, they had a bit of a following and were starting to get more regular bookings. So Cold Chisel had to opt for a different option to record this album. They played gigs all the time, and when they had a spare couple of days, they would re-enter the studio and try to record a song. And Don Walker said in retrospect that it probably didn't help the vibe of the album, because one day they're thinking of being a live band, and then they had to, the very next day, almost overnight, stop thinking about being a live band and start being a recording band. Now, when you've only recorded one album and don't have a lot of experience, that's challenging. That is challenging. But that was the deal, and that's what they had to work with. Working with Richard Batchens was a challenge as well. He was a producer that had his ideas in his head and wanted the record to sound a particular way and wanted the band to achieve a certain level of perfection with recording. And, you know, Cold Chisel, still learning to be a recording band, that was a challenge as well. So they had to deal with those emotional issues with the production as well as doing gigs regularly and having to fit that in small spaces of time with a person that they weren't quite gelling with as a producer. Now, despite all the friction that Cold Chisel were having in the early days of recording Breakfast at Sweethearts album, in September of 78, they managed to put together a song to be released as a single, and that song was Goodbye Astrid Goodbye, which is, you know, a classic Chisel song. But as Chisel were an albums band, and singles didn't matter to much as them, it probably wasn't a big deal that it didn't get very high in the charts. In fact, it charted lower than Kaysan. However, because it was released, Chisel were then given a license now to officially add the song to their set list at concerts. And they used it as a closing song, you know, goodbye. It's a rock and roll way to say goodbye after a show. So I think that was the real purpose for them releasing that song when they did. But, you know, the song was also going to appear on their next album, so it was a good lead-in for what was to come. So in all, Breakfast at Sweethearts, the album, took 6 months to record on and off. And it was a 10-song album. I think there may have actually been 13 songs recorded, but 10 songs made the final cut. And it was finally released in February 1979. Showtime. Hang a guitar on my shoulder, check the vacant drooling faces. The album cover artwork is made to look like the band is in an actual cafe, and it could very well be the Sweethearts Cafe, but the liner notes actually tell you that the location for that photo was the Sydney Hilton Hotel Marble Bar. The Marble Bar still is in operation today, and you can certainly go in there and have a drink. It is very opulent. And Jimmy Barnes later said that the Marble Bar was not a place Cold Chisel would ever go for a drink. The band was not really the clientele that would frequent a place like the Marble Bar. I think the album cover works because it is a good visual representation of what's on the album. It's dark, it's moody, it's got a bit of claustrophobia. There's a band in there that look like a gang you wouldn't want to run into late at night. On the reverse side is a solitary female. She could well be the character Anne Maria in the song Breakfast at Sweethearts. And the rest of the album's package has all the lyrics to the songs and photos of the individual members of the band in a collage. But overall, the album is packaged very well, and I think it delivers on setting the tone visually for the album. The opening track on the album, Conversations, is a ripper of a song to open the album with. It starts off with a solo piano vamp, and then the bass comes in, then the drums, and then Jimmy lets out a scream, and then the whole band kicks in. And it's got an oompah kind of rhythm to it, but it is definitely rockabilly. The song introduces a couple of characters, one dodgy character by the name of Billy, and it looks like he's probably waiting for an opportunity to steal some money from the hotel foyer. And the unnamed busker is kind of a witness, but he departs the scene and sort of Billy is set up to do what he thinks he's going to do. And that is very much in theme with the album, and I think it's set in King's Cross because, as we know, King's Cross sometimes has high crime rate and sometimes has dodgy people. But it is a really good observational song of characters and people in a place that most Australians probably wouldn't visit, but this is the reality of life in suburban city Australia. Track two, Merry-Go-Round, another great fast rockabilly number, and that was recorded the year before for the live EP You're 13, You're Beautiful and You're Mine. And it's got another unnamed character, but this time the character lives out in the sticks at a place called Coppenhurst, which is kind of near Tenterfield area, New England area. And he's not getting much luck in his life with the ladies, and his frustration is overwhelming to the point where I'm just going to move to the city. I'm sick of this living out in the sticks. And I got the feeling that when he's going to move to the city, he's probably going to move to King's Cross, but ripper of a song all the way. The third song on the album is my personal favourite song, and it is one of my all-time favourite Cold Chisel songs, and I can't get enough of it. It's called Dresden, and it is about the city in Germany that was firebombed to obliteration by the Allies in the Second World War. The lyrics aren't very clear. It's one of those songs where you really have to read the lyrics to find out what Don Walker is really trying to say about what happened there in the Second World War. He talks of imagery of cattle on trains, the traveller on his own, and I think that could be a metaphor for the Holocaust victims being taken away in trains like cattle to meet their fate at concentration camps. And it kind of says, was the bombing of Dresden justified because of what was happening in the Holocaust? And not an easy question to answer in the perspective of what happened to Dresden, but all the same, because it makes you think, and it is a very sensitive song, it's very powerful. I like it also because of the use of Don's piano and Ian Moss's guitar licks. It just sounds brilliant, and it builds up, and Jimmy Barnes's vocal is very emotional, and I just can't help it. I get shivers down my spine when I hear this song, and I just rate it so highly. It used to be called Dresden Blues, but I don't think Cold Chisel performed it live all that much. But it really makes this album worth listening to, just this song alone. The fourth track on the album, Goodbye Astrid Goodbye, is a bona fide Chisel classic. I don't know any Chisel fans that don't like this song. I think it is an absolute classic rockabilly hard rock song. Yep, a relationship breakdown, turning very sour very quickly. Don't offer to drive me around the station, you'll just drive me around the bend, is like, that's a full-on lyric if you ask me. But who was Astrid? I don't know. But, you know, when you hear this song, The recording of it's very good, but when you hear it live, it's just unreal. So, yeah, listen to the album for this song as well. Fifth track is a change of pace for the album. It slows right down and we just get Don Walker on piano with Ian Moss singing the vocal line. The song's called Plaza and it's inspired by Don Walker's own personal existence, living in Sydney on his own in Sydney, and talks about the difficulties of everyday life, living alone. No one knows you, no one trusts you, and still you want to have the pleasures, the simple pleasures of life, you know, meeting people, hanging out, and occasionally hitting the stage as a rock artist. But it's a very quiet song. Ian Moss's vocals are silky smooth, and I think it's very good, and its purpose is met because it does break the album up just that little bit before side two. So if it was an LP, this would be side two, but on CD, this is track number 6, and that song is Shipping Steel, a trucky song, and I think it is the best trucky song since Slim Dusty's Lights on the Hill. And when you listen to the song, it doesn't take long to work out that is actually the Bo Diddley beat set to an Australian theme. And like Conversations, it's got a really good chorus. And it's very blokey, very testosterone song. I think truckies around the country would see this as their hard rock anthem. And it was released as a single. It didn't do very well, but it's grown in popularity over the years. So Shipping Steel, the Truckee Anthem by Cold Chisel. Just a great, great song. Now, track number 7, I'm Gonna Roll Ya. This is a good song. It's got a great melody, great rhythm. It's very heavy, very rockabilly. Now, it is also very misogynistic, I would say. It's about the band getting with groupies, like, all I want to do is get laid is one of the lyrics. You know, it's all about partying after concerts, getting with groupies, that sort of thing. Would the band play it today? Would it be recorded today? I don't think so. I think it's of the time. But yeah, I'll probably leave this one to the record. Great song, but yeah, it's very blokey. It's very blokey. You'll just have to listen to it to get and read the lyrics to understand what I'm talking about. Track number 8 is called Showtime, and it really is a statement on the music industry for bands trying to make it. To me, it's reflective of Cold Chisel's life as a band when they started to play in Adelaide, to moving to Melbourne, not being very successful, to then moving to Sydney, and how the industry says one thing, does the other. The crowd only like you when you're already famous. There's no in between. You just have to be famous or they don't care about you at all. All the blood, sweat, and tears that you put into your music, suffering for your art, is barely rewarded. But the song is kind of analogous to drug addiction. The narrator of the song just, I've got no other thing in life now but my music. I know it's not helping me get through life easily, but I'm so addicted that I got no other way of living, and this is all I'm ever gonna do. Lord, I'm just a trooper, he says at the end. Let me play it one more time. So if you're a musician and you want a realistic picture of the industry and the sacrifices you have to make in your life to get that music fixed live on stage to probably an unappreciative crowd, which is most of the time, then this is your song. It is your anthem. Every musician who's trying to make it in the industry, pay attention to this song. So now we come to track 9, which is the title track, Breakfast at Sweethearts, the song. Breakfast at Sweethearts is one of the best Chisel songs ever. And it really fits the mood of the song. And it has been said that this song represents King's Cross probably better than any other song. The song is about an actual place in King's Cross called Sweethearts, where Don Walker frequented a lot. And he would write his lyrics for his songs there sometimes. And one of the songs that he wrote there was Kaysan. Now, the actual restaurant itself, cafe, is no longer there. A McDonald's stands in its place. I hope that the government will see the heritage value of that location and put a plaque there to say, this is where the lyrics for Kaysan were written. This was the inspiration for Breakfast at Sweethearts. Absolutely ridiculous if they don't, in my opinion. But like Conversations, Sweethearts takes us back to King's Cross, and it talks about the next morning like a hangover, and you just want some oily, greasy breakfast food, and the best place for that in King's Cross is a cafe called Sweethearts. And a lot of different people, dodgy people, criminals, police, you name it, every character in King's Cross goes to Sweethearts and reflects on their lives and what happened the night before. And it's got a really good mood. Some people say it's a reggae song. I don't know if it really is a reggae song, but you know, you really could sit back in a cafe and listen to this sort of music to relax on the weekend. That's the feel of the song. And it was re-recorded, but I think the recording on this album, the original, is the best. And Don Walker, just, I think his maturity as a songwriter is reflected in this particular song. And once again, if you're going to listen to this album, this is the song to listen to. Just is one of the very best Chisel songs. The last song on the album, very similar to Conversations in rhythm, it's called The Door. It's got like an umpah rhythm. I think it is The Shadows' Walk Don't Run on methamphetamine or something. It's a very fast rhythm. And it's very aggressive. And I reckon it sounds really cool. But I think the story of the song is told from a female perspective. And her husband or boyfriend or whatever is probably a drug dealer. And something has gone wrong, and now every night they're being harassed by people who want money or think they're owed something. And it's about living in the suburbs but feeling very vulnerable and very alone. I think it's a ripper of an ending song, actually. I didn't like it initially, but when in the context of the album as a bookend with Conversations, it really works. And if it's got that chord progression continually happening, it sounds a bit old school, but it's a very aggressive version of that chord progression and very testosterone filled song. I think it's a great way to end the album. I couldn't think of another song ending the album, actually. So that's it. That's the track list and my thoughts on the songs for the album Breakfast at Sweethearts. Breakfast at Sweethearts, to me, is an underrated Australian music masterpiece. Cold Chisel look back on the album and don't speak fondly of it, but they're not talking about the songs. I think Cold Chisel loved the songs on the album. They just weren't happy with the overall sound. Richard Batchens, you know, a competent engineer, he still managed to keep a sonically consistent sound throughout every song throughout the album. There's no one song that is sonically different from another, so it is contained very well in that way. Yep, the mixing job. Sometimes you can't hear Jimmy's voice over the instruments. Sometimes the bass is just a little too fat. The drums sound damp throughout. The use of an acoustic piano isn't really going to replicate well on stage, considering Don was always using electric keyboards. And I think in the subsequent albums, Don was recording with the keyboards that he would be using on stage. But the songs themselves save the album. And Chisel were in and out of the studio for 6 months doing this. It's hard to set up all your instruments and get them all to sound exactly the same every time, but they managed to do it. And Ian Moss's guitar is a terrific example. His guitar in this album, the sound of it just sounds excellent. It's ballsy, it's got grit, And it's one of the only instruments on the album that's got reverb heavily on it. And that sounds good. It's just a bit of a shame that the rest of the album didn't quite get the same mix as Mossy's guitar. But in true Cold Chisel philosophical fashion, it really was an album for an album's sake. I don't think it needed any singles. Maybe Breakfast at Sweethearts, probably. But the album stands alone without the need for single songs. It's very listenable from start to finish. The album sold well. It reached number 4 on the charts. It was a breakthrough. So as a second album, it actually did its job. And Cold Chisel started to become a band Australia-wide that people knew about and wanted to see. Cold Chisel chose not to work with Batchens again, which is kind of not a surprise, but at the end of the day, they created the second album. It sold. Chisel were then able to use that experience and build upon it for their next album. They were writing so many songs, but it certainly was an experience for them to become better musicians and better recording artists through that experience. So that was a review of an underrated Aussie music masterpiece, Cold Chisel's Breakfast at Sweethearts album of 1979. If you like the album, please leave a comment. If you think there are better albums or it doesn't deserve any praise, then leave a comment. Let us know. What's your favourite Chisel memory or moment? Do you have the album? What would you say is the best song on the album? All your comments. I'll get to them, I'll have a read, and definitely, if you've got it in your car, put it on and give it a good old blast.
Well, thanks for watching, and I really appreciate that you made it this far, and Chisel fans unite, I say. If you want to see more content like this, or you have an album in mind that you think's underrated that perhaps I could do a video on, please let me know in the comments. And the best way to support me is just to hit the subscribe and the like button. Look me up on Facebook, share with your friends. In the meantime, I'm Threads, this is E Says, and have a good one.